centuries before Christ. These psalms are the ancient hymn of the Hebrews. Many texts are ascribed to King David, an ancient ruler of Israel, though their authorship is much broader. Psalm 137, for instance, makes reference to the Babylonian captivity of Israel 4 centuries after David. Those who use it for worship. Introduction. Church music composers today have a unique vantage point compared to their counterparts in centuries past. They have within their reach a vast body of worship and musical traditions to draw from as they create their art. The compass of such a historical palette is staggering. Millennia of musical forms, the documented evolution of instruments and instrument families, endless categories of musical traditions. What is more, we live in a day when musicians and artisans alike are eager to reproduce in high fidelity the instruments, sounds, and practices found throughout recorded history. It can be daunting to even scratch the surface of what is available to study and research, let alone to sufficiently immerse oneself in a distinct facet of this subject. This lecture recital represents the culmination of several performance degrees in organ and church music, with additional studies in composition. 8 distinctive pieces of worship music have been created as a small sampling of the forms and traditions in which modern church music composers may create. Each piece will be considered both in formal analysis and with respect to the history or tradition or style in which it is written. As mentioned before, this brief survey falls short of evoking the immeasurable scope of the topic being considered. Part of the question composers may ask themselves is where they fit in the larger scheme of what has already been created. This question will be addressed in the course of the lecture recital as each piece is considered. Although trying to see where one's music fits into the repertoire seems valid enough, an even more pointed question can take precedence. How will these compositions impact those who hear them? The composer's relationship with his or her audience can make a big difference in what is produced. Although this latter consideration has been the focal driving point for the creation of these works, this point will not be addressed specifically in the course of this lecture recital. Psalm 150, let everything that hath breath. Two prominent and historically associated religions, Judaism and Christianity, are examples of traditions where worship and music are intricately intertwined. Although Judaism still exists today as a distinct remnant of ancient Hebrew worship, it was also once the birthplace of Christianity 2 millennia ago. This important fact helps explain the common sources of musical inspiration shared by these two religions. The Book of Hebrew Scripture, the Tanakh, constitutes much of what is accepted by Christianity as the Old Testament in the Holy Bible. Within the Tanakh, or Old Testament, is the Book of Psalms, known in Hebrew as Tehillim, literally, praises. It is a collection of 150 sacred poems dating back centuries before Christ. These psalms are the ancient hymnal of the Hebrews. Many texts are ascribed to King David, an ancient ruler of Israel, though their authorship is much darker. Psalm 137, for instance, makes reference to the Babylonian captivity of Israel 4 centuries after King David. Psalms continue to be important to Jews who converted to Christianity in the 1st century. This can be seen in the fact that of the 283 Old Testament citations found in the New Testament, 116 come directly from the Psalms. This poetic book continues to appear in the Christian canon of Scripture for Orthodox, Catholic, and Protestant editions of the Bible. Numerous books have been written about the use of psalms in Christian liturgy and worship. The scope of this paper does not allow for an
consideration. Suffice it to say that psalms are ubiquitous in the history and tradition of Christian music. They have functioned liturgically and have been cantillated or chanted since antiquity. They are used outside of worship services for personal devotion. They have been paraphrased, translated, arranged, and formed into immeasurable body of musical settings, whether Christian, Jewish, or otherwise, over the past 3,000 years. The book Psalms for All Seasons was created by the Calvin Institute of Christian Worship in 2012. As a psalter, it helps to capture a wide variety of the traditions of psalm settings. Each of the 150 psalms is represented in the collection by numerous modern and historical approaches. For instance, the section for Psalm 150 contains 10 separate settings. Some are by international composers and evoke the rhythms and harmonies of their native traditions. There are contemporary settings, which tend to evoke a more pop idiom with pianistic accompaniments. There are also more historical settings by European authors and composers of metric songs, paraphrases, which use four-part hymn tunes. There are responsorial settings, which engage the congregation in response to a cantor. This book is an invaluable resource for modern church musicians. The final song of the Tehillim is known by its Latin enchantment as Laudate Domini in Sanctus Deus, or in English, Praise ye the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary. This psalm is only 6 verses long in the King James Version of the Bible. In those few verses, it lists no less than 8 different categories of instruments: the trumpet, the psaltery, the harp, the timbre, the stringed instruments, organs, loud cymbals, and high sounding cymbals. It also invites one to praise God through dance. In essence, this psalm is a cultural timestamp, both of available musical forces and of accepted practices for ancient Hebrew worship. For this lecture recital, Psalm 150 has been set as a responsorial psalm. Such settings are created with an antiphon, generated from a distinctive line of song, and acting as a refrain between other lines of the poetry. In this setting, the first phrase of verse 6 serves as the antiphon text. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Traditionally, the cantor will introduce the antiphon. The congregation will then join in singing the antiphon in every subsequent instance. This piece is set as a contemporary harmonic idiom and is made to be functional in modern liturgical traditions. Michel Guimont's collection, Lectionary Psalms, served as the model for this composition. Some complementary liturgical contemporary liturgical composers like to harken back to the modality of Gregorian chant in an attempt to bridge past and present sensibilities. In that spirit, this F major song uses an E flat in the final bar to evoke the Minxin She. The 6 verses of Psalm 150 have been regrouped into 3 sum verses for the responsorial setting, merging consecutive verses in pairs for each sum verse. This approach was a creative decision related to the length of the text versus the length of the harmonic progressions. In this tradition, the verses are set to a non-rhythmic, harmonically embellished melody. The first several words of the verse are sung to a stationary note and harmony, moving to a new note and chord only towards the end of the textual clause. Thus, verbal endings are accentuated by shifting chords or cadences, underscoring recitative-like nature of this tradition. setting it up for a return to the antiphon. The tonic cadence of the antiphon allows it also to function as the end of the piece. Behold the mountain of the Lord. Defining the word "him" is more difficult than one might think. In their book, Sing with Understanding, Harry Eskew and P.T. McGellar quote Carl F. Price in their introduction with respect to his attempt to define the word "him" in specific terms. Quote, "A Christian hymn is a lyric poem, reverently and devotionally conceived, which is designed to be sung, and which expresses the worshipper's attitude toward God or God's purposes in human life. It should be simple and metrical in form, genuinely emotional, poetic, and literary in style, spiritual in quality, and in its ideas so direct and so immediately apparent as to unify the congregation while singing it." End quote. This definition, they point out, was later abandoned by the Hymn Society's research committee for a far more inclusive statement. Quote, "The hymn may be regarded as a congregational song." End quote. Although hymns take many forms and come from a plethora of traditions, the following generalities help to describe Christian hymning. After the 16th century reforms, Western hymning was primarily metrical and strophic. Some hymns are simply free verse. Some have refrains or a chorus. In many languages, poetry rhymes. It is most often intended for singing by the entire congregation in worship. The English word hymn derives from the Greek word hymnos. An early use in Christian literature is found in Matthew 26, verse 30. Quote, "And when they had sung a hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives." End quote. The Apostle Paul speaks of singing hymns, as do the early Christian fathers. John Chrysostom, for instance, stated, quote, "From the spiritual hymns, however, proceeds much value, much utility and sanctity. For the words purify the mind, and the Holy Spirit descends swiftly upon the mind of the singer. For those who sing with understanding invoke the grace of the Spirit." End quote. Christian hymnody developed throughout medieval Europe and experienced an explosion of creativity in the Renaissance with the Protestant Reformation. The offshoot denominations from the Reformation would each in turn add to the wealth of hymnody throughout the centuries. Even today, the creation of Christian hymns on a global level is alive and well. This leads us to the next piece on the lecture cycle. The text of the hymn, "Behold the Mountain of the Lord," was written by Michael Bruce, the son of a Scottish weaver. His short life included aspirations to enter the ministry and studies at Edinburgh University. He wrote 28 hymns before his untimely death. The text of "Behold the Mountain of the Lord" is a rhyming strophic paraphrase of Isaiah chapter 2, verses 2 through 5. The first several verses of Micah chapter 4 in the Old Testament also quote this Isaiah prophecy, adding further description of the day when the Lord will reign on earth in Zion. The newly composed tune, "Bainbridge," serves as the hymn tune. Formally, this tune compares to several well-known tunes, such as "Converse," "Forest Green," "Revelation," "Elegon," and "Kingsfold." In these tunes, each line of music ends on a longer note value, Each of the hymns is also some variant of the musical form AABA. Converse, for instance, follows the AABA pattern without variation. In contrast, Ellicott and Kingsfold follow the form AA prime, BA prime, where the second line of music varies slightly from the first, and the fourth line is a repeat of the second. Bainbridge compares most directly to the hymn tune, Revelation, written by Evan Stevens. In this hymn, the form is AA prime, BA double prime, which still adheres to the general AABA mold, but has variation in the A material in every instance. This helps to keep the musical clauses fresh. There is unity through repetition without repeating any phrase verbatim. Some other elements which I intentionally wove into this hymn include my use of the repeated A-flat soprano notes in bars 1, 5, 9, and 11, with the first E-flat acting as an anacrusis. Felix Mendelssohn's Festgesang, adapted for the use with Hark the Herald Angels Sing, hits three repeated high notes halfway through the tune. This fanfare gesture has become characteristic of the hymn. The partial employment of this technique is intended to evoke the idea of a small fanfare in Bainbridge. Another intentional technique used to color this hymn was the final cadence. This piece is in A-flat major, but the penultimate bar is comprised of four chords built on D-flat, the subdominant of A-flat. In Protestant hymnody, such playable cadences are evocative of an amen. Whether the affect is subconscious, or whether it ends up just making the hymn sound more distinctive, the playable ending was intentional.
Thank you.
according to the Canterbury Dictionary of Hymnology, a hymn anthem is described as follows, quote, a choral form used by composers in setting hymns, metrical songs, and religious poetry, using the associated hymn tune or composing original music. While English composers were among the first to write hymn anthems, the form is especially popular in the United States, where it has become a principal type of published sacred music. One category of hymn anthem includes works based on both a hymn text and hymn tune. As with concertato hymn settings, composers of this type of hymn anthem frequently employ pre-harmonizations, changing instrumentation and textures, varying choral settings, descants, key changes, and congregational participation to create musical variety. End quote. A hymn anthem might also be referred to as a hymn setting or a hymn arrangement. John Rutter's For the Beauty of the Earth, published in 1980, is a prime example of this form. Rutter uses the first four verses of S.F. Pierpoint's well-known hymn. Though the text is often sung to the tune Dix, Rutter chooses to create his own melody for the piece. This arrangement employs many elements of typical hymn anthems, including the use of musical motives, varied textures, key changes, dynamic variety, and distinctive instrumentation. During my time as director of sacred arts at First United Methodist Church in Leavenworth, Kansas, I worked with a variety of choral and handbell ensembles. These serve as the inspiration of my setting of Jesus Savior Pilate Me. Much like Rutter's setting of For the Beauty, I begin with a light ostinato introduction, though mine is in Handel choir, performed tonight on the celesta. The sopranos and altos carry the first half of the verse with the bell accompaniment. The tenors and basses then join in, building to the interlude, where piano accompaniment takes over the bell performed tonight on the organ. Verse 2 is similar to Hymn Book Harmonies, with some alterations for the voices. The bells are tasseled at measure 19, allowing the deep, rich left hand of the piano to underscore the choral harmonies. The second verse concludes in SATD, leading to the bridge. It is an instrumental break to showcase the bells. The writing for bell choir is once again very idiomatic of a carol or bell tower, starting softer and gradually growing dynamically towards the entrance of the final verse. For dramatic effect, the choir enters the final verse in a fortissimo unison, breaking into harmony after the initial line of poetry. The piano enters with the voices, acting to reinforce harmonies and to underscore powerful bass line. All of the previous motives and gestures return for this verse as all three elements, bells, voices, and piano, join full capacity. The final line of the third verse brings the piece down from its climax, pausing momentarily on a fermata. Jesus Savior ends by repeating the final line of the hymn at a slower pace and in augmentation, an oft-used formula in hymn anthems. The bells and piano then launch into a short coda, slowing to the final cadence. The imagery of this beloved Protestant hymn evokes scenes from Jesus' ministry, where he calms the wild tempest on the Sea of Galilee. As is often the case, life events become a metaphor in music worship. Hoping to capture the emotion of turmoil serenity of the inner soul through real-world descriptors. The pursuit of peace amidst life's extremities is at the very heart of the Christian hope for deliverance. Lost here without you. Simply stated, contemporary Christian music, or CCM, is the confluence of modern, sacred, and secular music traditions. As mentioned above, the Apostle Paul encouraged the singing not only of psalms and hymns, but of spiritual songs as well. This confluence of sacred and popular is not altogether unprecedented in history. Martin Luther, for example, chose to repurpose popular tunes of his day with more sacred lyrics. A great heated debate has surrounded CCM since its inception. The following are some of the questions I have encountered as a church musician. In what proportions may someone mix together the sacred and the profane and still end up with a predominantly holy concoction? Is such a course of action spiritually viable? Is it liturgically functional? What is the quality of the music? Is it so nuanced by the fleeting tastes of style and harmony as to negate any sort of shelf life and lasting relevance? Is CCM merely a financially driven arm of the music industry, finding new niche in worship? Since the mid-20th century, these and other complex questions have relentlessly plagued music ministers and clergy alike. For better or for worse, CCM has become a fixed and rapidly growing facet of modern Christianity. We now live in a day where entire congregations of worshipers have never experienced worship without it. A growing number of radio and internet music stations are dedicated to broadcasting CCM. It is a genre and medium so accessible as to render it within the grasp of even those with limited musical education. It does not have a specific distinctive sound, as do other genres of contemporary music, such as rock, country, or pop. In fact, it encompasses many all genres of music. A Christian music artist may feasibly create his or her songs in any mainstream genre or style. The composition, Lost Here Without You, began as a romantic song evoking the feeling of being alone and longing for a reunion. As the process of composing progressed, the piece began to take on a decidedly religious character. The emotions seemed to parallel seasons of spiritual and existential crisis that many tend to experience in life. The song became a desperate plea to God rather than a song of romantic longing. The fact that a contemporary Christian song can carry lyrics with possible double meaning or interpretation is not unprecedented. Similarly, it is interesting to note the frequency of crossover artists in the CCM industry. People such as Amy Grant, Peter Cetera, Matt Harmon, Hilary Scott, Avril Lavigne, and mainstream bands such as Switchfoot, Breaking Benjamin, Creed, Lifehouse, and Skillet are just a few prime examples. All of them have created songs which have either covert or overt religious meaning. Some of their songs can also be interpreted as having more secular meaning in one context and religious implications in another. The song Lost Here Without You begins with an urgent and undulating piano introduction in C-sharp minor. The lyrics draw a metaphor, mixing the imagery of passing time and scenes of fading daylight on the shore. As is a common formal practice for contemporary popular music, verse 1 is followed immediately by verse 2, a continuation of the empty pleas. Measure 39 sees the first entrance of the presses forward. The first statement, the chorus, in measure 48, enters exclaiming the title of the song. The emotion is one of desperation mixed with determination. Quote, "I won't leave without you. There's nowhere else to go." End quote. The end of the chorus dies back down dynamically with a short transition leading back to the C-sharp minor motive of the introduction. As is also modern practice, verse 3 enters without the consequent fourth verse, contrasting from the beginning of the song. It leads directly into the second statement of the pre-chorus, which has altered lyrics from the first. It asserts, "I'll search until you find me." The pre-chorus builds into the second chorus. This time, the chorus gives way into the bridge, a turning point where the singer has an epiphany about his or her relationship with God. Quote, "I think I've come to know all I ever have prayed or hoped to be is found in your gentle and perfect love for me." End quote. The bridge takes a short detour to G major before heading back into E major for the final statement of the chorus. This time the lyrics are more certain, proclaiming, "I know I feel you now," but still continues to implore God. This final statement of the chorus is also different in that the pre-chorus material appears towards the end of the chorus, giving the individual a chance to express personal commitment to God while reminiscing that God gave his all to love the individual. This is an allusion to the Christian theology of the atonement of Jesus Christ. The piece ends while repeating the phrase, "I give my all to you," as the piano accompaniment recedes in motive similar to the start. Large-scale, multi-movement sacred works have been created by many notable composers throughout the centuries. Georg Friedrich Handel's Messiah has become one of the most recognizable large-scale musical works about Christ in our day. Johann Sebastian Bach first conducted his St. Martin Passion in 1727. The text for Passions comes directly from one of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. What some consider as Bach's magnum opus in choral writing, the B minor Mass, stands as a formidable conquest for performing ensembles and as an awesome compositional inspiration to future generations. Some modern day examples of multi-movement sacred works are James McMillan's work, Seven Last Words from the Cross, as well as S. Andrew Lloyd's Christus. There have also been several musical settings of the texts from the Savior's Sermon on the Mount. This discourse constitutes Jesus' introduction of the higher law to fulfill the law of Moses. Quote, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill." End quote. The first section of this sermon is a series of statements which all begin with, "Blessed are." The Latin word from which this is translated, "beatus," means to be fortunate, to be happy, or to be blessed. This Latin word is the source of our modern term, beatitude, in English. Jesus discourses on the happy, the blessed state of those who live the higher law. In some respects, this might be thought of as the Sermon up the Mount. It is an ideological and theological climb as consecutive principles build upon each other. The piece, "Blessed Are," is a musical setting of Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 through 10, for baritone and organ accompaniment. It is intended to be part of a multi-movement sacred work entitled, "What Think Ye of Christ?" The piece begins in C major, with progressive treatments of each beatitude. For instance, the first declaration, "Blessed are the poor in spirit," continues in C major from the organ introduction, but shifts harmonically with the second clause, "For theirs is the kingdom of heaven." This treatment of text throughout through modulation, text printing, and various motivic gestures work to capture the progressive nature of each succeeding beatitude. Another movement from "What Think Ye of Christ?" "Comes Jesus Come" is connected to "Blessed Are" in several important and intentional ways. Although the text does not come directly from the scripture, "This is my own poetry," it is inspired by the story of Christ's nativity found in the Bible. Similar to "Blessed Are," this piece changes tonal centers with each consecutive verse. The material from measures 47 through 50 compared to measures 78 through 81, "Blessed Are." The ending of both pieces is nearly identical. The treatment of the word "righteousness" and "Blessed Are" compares to the melodic contour in measures 9 and 11, "Come Sweet Jesus Come." Even the contour of the head motive in the melody of both pieces is meant to be similar. The placement of these two movements in "What Think Ye of Christ" creates a chiasmus in the larger form of the work. The two movements reflect one another on either side of a central movement. The decision to take sacred text or subject matter and set it to music is not a light one. The hope is that music can act as a vehicle to carry the message of these words to others. Music can augment the message. adding more than one dimension to the delivery. They can work to bypass intellectual walls, appealing often to emotional sensibilities. Some of the deepest convictions can be those which have met at the crossroads of the intellectual, emotional, and spiritual juncture of the mind. The yet unfinished work, What Think Ye of Christ, seeks to take part in this. At the cross. By the time of the Council of Trent, hundreds of sequences were in existence. These chants, or hymns, functioned liturgically, appearing after the Alleluia of the Mass, immediately before the Gospel reading. The sequence had grown out of a melismatic ending of the Alleluia itself, the Eucharist, eventually becoming a separate form and facet of the Mass. The decisions of the aforementioned council produced the Missale Romana of 1570, which thereafter sanctioned only four sequences: Victime Paschali Laudis for Holy Week, Veni Sancte Spiritus for Pentecost, Laudation Salvatore for the Feast of Corpus Christi, and Dies Irae, functional role at Masses for the Dead and for All Souls Day. It would be another century and a half before Stabat Mater was officially sanctioned and added to this list. This hymn to the Blessed Virgin Mary evokes the final scene of Jesus' mortal life as his mother suffers at saving her own son in agony. This intimate Latin poetry is 20 verses in tercet form. The first two lines of each verse have rhyming endings. The third lines of every consecutive pair of verses have rhyming endings. Edward Caswell created a rhyming paraphrase of this sequence in English, attempting to preserve the original metric foot. This setting of Stabat Mater at the cross utilizes the first three verses of Caswell's paraphrase, interchanging the second and third verses. This piece is written on four staves and is intended for a cappella SSAATTBB choir. It is in ternary form, ABA prime. The slow pace and thin texture at the outset are meant to evoke an intimate yet heartrending scene. Initially, the part writing seems homophonic, but with no clear melody. Bar 5 sees the first eight notes in the soprano and alto parts, drawing attention to the end of the phrase. Further text painting enters in bar 8, as the parts begin to seem pointillistic and easy. More eight notes round out the second phrase of music, concluding the first verse of the text. A key change from two flats to no flats initiates the independent polyphony of the second verse. The rising and falling gesture introduced by the tenors gets treated in imitation among the voices as the text and music climax to a fermata of bar 17. The soprano and alto voices descend, and the tenor entrance in bar 19 segues into the third verse, the voices return to two flats. This final verse is an altered treatment of the first verse, revisiting musical ideas from the beginning. The sopranos are divided with the upper voice carrying four and eighth notes. This A prime section also shifts from focusing on Mary's sufferings for her son to Christ's sufferings for mankind. Eighth note gestures begin to appear in all the voices. Harmonies continue to become tighter and shift in affect of the text. Bar 30 sees an augmented tribute of the final A material, creating a coda. All four parts repeat the phrase, "The bitter cup is passed," in their turn, as rhythms, both actual and harmonic, slow to the final bar. Measure 33 shifts to half notes in 3-2, and the piece cadences on a 10 flat sus2 chord, calling into question whether this ending was truly the end. As in the narrative musical settings of scripture mentioned above, this setting of stabat mater might feel as though it is only a small part of a bigger story. A major tenet of Christian theology is the idea that God experienced suffering and death on behalf of each individual. The hope is that in some small measure, this piece will capture and convey this thought. Liturgical suite on Helmsley. Charles Turner was a post-romantic organist and composer in France. One of his most important works for organ is his Loganbill, a collection of 51 settings of the Mass Propers, intended for use throughout the liturgical year. These are each made up of 5 movements: Prelude on the Introit, Offertoire, Elevation, Communion, and finally, Pièce Terminale. They are based on Gregorian chants appropriate to each feast or solemnity they observe during a given week. In general, the first 4 movements of each piece are short, sometimes only a page in length. The final movement of each of these 51 settings tends to be larger, typically toccata style. One of Turner's close friends and associates was the organist Maurice Durf. Durf, too, was a composer of sacred music. Much of his music for organ use has strong roots in worship. His piece, Prelude and Darja, the choral variations on the theme in Creator, Opus 4, is a masterful exploration of a beloved Gregorian chant. It is interesting to note that the final section of the piece, the choral variations, are curiously similar in format to Turner's settings of the 5 Mass Propers in Loganbill. The first page is an introductory harmonization of the Vain Creator chant, much like the Introit. Thereafter, follow 3 more settings of the chant, each no more than a page, and each in a different character, analogous to the Offertory, Elevation, and Communion pieces in Loganbill. The final variation is a toccata treatment of the chant, comparable to Turner's Sorties. This intriguing similarity was the inspiration for the creation of my liturgical suite on Helmsley. The tune around which this piece was created, Helmsley, is often paired with the hymn text, "Lo, he comes with clouds descending." This hymn depicts events associated with the Christian doctrine of Jesus' second advent and millennial reign. The first movement of this piece, the Prelude, is a 1-page meditation on the head motive of Helmsley. In the swell, a middle G is tied throughout most of the piece, adding a tentative and suspended effect as a 4-foot flute introduces the head motive of Helmsley on the grate. The decision to call this movement Prelude rather than Introit is an attempt to avoid strict prescription of its use liturgically. The next movement, the Offertoire, sets the first musical portion of Helmsley, specifically the repeating A material of the tune. This movement is written as a canon between the swell and the pedal, with a mandolin carrying the cantus firmus and rhythmic division. Its harmonic language contrasts with the more tonal setting. There is less concern about functional harmony as the canon plays out. The registration is also partial. A 4-foot flute and a 2 2/3 bizarre in the grate coupled to the pedal, which also has an 8-foot box minor coupled from the swell. The offertoire ends with open fifths around on 3-foot distance. The middle movement is the elevation of the mass. It treats the middle phrase of Helmsley in 9-8. And on the delicate sound of a 4-foot flute. This fragment of the cantus firmus is in augmentation as triplet eighth notes dance around in very tonal harmonies. It compares in some degree to In Dulce Jubilo from Bach's Orgelbriefland. Although the piece is in G major, it cadences on an F major harmony, helping to avoid a sense of conclusion. The communion draws on an unusual registration, all 16 foot stops in the manuals and pedals. As with the elevation, this movement's harmonies and musical gestures are reminiscent of works in the organ repertoire, such as Brahms' Opus 122 or Bach's 499. This fourth movement is in ternary form, treating the final musical phrase HELMSLEY three times. It cadences on a solid G major chord, giving it a sense of conclusion to the treatments of the three musical phrases of HELMSLEY. The final movement of this work is entitled Sortie d'urgence. This could be interpreted as meaning a sortie of urgency, except that the phrase sortie d'urgence in French literally translates as emergency music. This play on words is intentional, mixing the pedestrian phrase, which I encounter on a French bus, with the urgent ideas contained in Lo He Comes with Clouds Descending. The toccata pattern in the manuals for this sortie is also intended to represent the sirens of an emergency vehicle, intensifying the idea of urgency. Rather than launching directly into the toccata pattern, however, the figuration enters in small, abbreviated chunks, punctuated by rests with fermatas. The beginning eventually picks up momentum and speed, also gradually crescendoing as the swell box opens. The cantus firmus of Helmsley enters in the pedals, stating the first section of the tune completely. It is stated once again in the pedals as the material in the manuals changes. In measures 12 and 13, the soprano line in the manuals picks up the last phrase in the A material of Helmsley, bringing the section to a strong and decided cadence. An abrupt key change in foreshortens sees a repeat of the opening material of the sortie up on the swell and with a slightly softer registration. This restatement of the first two pages of the sortie ends in measures 22 and 23, with the melody being carried once again in the manuals. In measure 24, a lengthy transition ensues, treating the head movement of the hymn tune as developmental material. We have used several different tonal centers, and finally the diminuendo of measure 30, moving back up to the swell for the next section of Helmsley. The pedals drop out as the two moves pass through the continual 16-note toccata configurations. This section ends as the motivic gestures swell upward toward a key change back to G major. In measure 39, we get a sense that we are in the home stretch of the toccata, as registrations continue to build and part rate climbs ever higher. Finally, the end section of Helmsley is stated in its entirety in measures 44 and 45. And a high G is tied over the coda material, where the head note of the hymn tune is repeated in the left hand. The entire piece ends in a powerful cadence. Conclusion. As one might gather from the various pieces of this lecture recital, a church music composer benefits greatly from extensive background knowledge of the many forms, styles, and genres available to him or her. It can also be seen that he or she can benefit greatly from having flexibility in the creative process. Though the subject is not considered here, as mentioned above, the composer's relationship with his or her audience decides in a great degree what he or she produces. For whom is the music being composed? How will the music impact the listener? Why is the composer creating the music? I have found each of these to be essential elements as I inspired to become a church music composer.